Introduction to Tea Drinking in 18th Century America, Its Etiquette and Equipage. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by David Wales. Tea Drinking in 18th Century America, Its Etiquette and Equipage by Rodris Roth. Introduction. In 18th century America, the pleasant practice of taking tea at home was an established social custom with a recognized code of manners and distinctive furnishings. Pride was taken in a correct and fashionable tea table, whose equipage included much more than teapot, cups, and saucers. It was usually the duty of the mistress to make and pour the tea, and it was the duty of the guests to be adept at handling a teacup and saucer, and to provide social chit-chat. Because of the expense and time involved, the tea party was limited to the upper classes. Consequently, such an affair was a status symbol. The cocktail party of the 20th century has, perhaps, replaced the tea party of the 18th century as a social custom, reflecting the contrast between the relaxed atmosphere of yesterday with the hurried pace of today. The author, Miss Roth, is Assistant Curator of Cultural History in the United States National Museum, Smithsonian Institution. End of introduction. Part 1 of Tea Drinking in 18th Century America by Rodris Roth. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. The Americans use much tea, noted the Abbé Robin during his visit to this country in 1781. The greatest mark of civility and welcome they can show you is to invite you to drink it with them. Tea was the social beverage of the 18th century. Serving it was a sign of politeness and hospitality, and drinking it was a custom with distinctive manners and specific equipment. Most discussions of the commodity have dealt only with its political, historical, or economic importance. However, in order to understand the place tea holds in this country's past, it also is important to consider the beverage in terms of the social life and traditions of the Americans. As the Abbé Robin pointed out, not only was tea an important commodity on this side of the Atlantic, but the imbibing of it was an established social practice. An examination of tea-time behavior and a consideration of what utensils were used, or thought appropriate, for tea-drinking are of help in reconstructing and interpreting American history, as well as in furnishing and recreating interiors of the period, thus bringing into clearer focus the picture of daily life in 18th-century America. For these reasons, and because the subject has received little attention, the present study has been undertaken. Tea had long been known and used in the Orient before it was introduced into Europe in the early part of the 17th century. At about the same time, two other new beverages appeared, chocolate from the Americas and coffee from the Near East. The presence of these commodities in European markets is indicative of the vigorous exploration and active trade of that century, which also witnessed the successful settlement of colonies in North America. By about mid-17th century, the new beverage was being drunk in England, and by the 1690s were being sold in New England. At first, chocolate was preferred, but coffee, being somewhat cheaper, soon replaced it, and in England gave rise to a number of public places of refreshment known as coffee houses. Coffee was, of course, the primary drink of these establishments, but that tea also was available is indicated by an advertisement that appeared in an English newspaper in 1658. One of the earliest advertisements for tea, it announced, "That excellent and by all physicians approved China drink, called by the Chineans cha, by other nations te, alias tea, is sold at the Sultaness Head, a coffee-house in Sweetings, rents by the Royal Exchange, London." For a time, tea was esteemed mainly for its curative powers, which explains why it was by all physicians approved. According to an English broadside published in 1660, the numerous contemporary ailments which tea helpeth included the headaches, giddiness, and heaviness. It was also considered good for colds, dropsies, and scurvies, and it expelleth infection. It prevents and cures agues, surfeits, and fevers. By the end of the 17th century, however, tea's medicinal qualities had become secondary to its fashionableness as a unique drink. Tea, along with the other exotic and novel imports from the Orient, such as fragile porcelains, lustrous silks, and painted wallpapers, had captured the European imaginations. Though the beverage was served in public pleasure gardens as well as coffee houses during the early 1700s in England, social tea-drinking in the home was gradually coming into favor. The coffee houses continued as centers of political, social, and literary influence, as well as of commercial life, into the first half of the 19th century, for apparently Englishmen preferred to drink their coffee in public rather than private houses, and among male rather than mixed company. This was in contrast to tea, which was drunk in the home with breakfast or as a morning beverage, and socially at afternoon gatherings of both sexes, as we see in the painting An English Family at Tea. As tea-drinking in the home became fashionable, both host and hostess took pride in a well-appointed tea-table, for a teapot of silver or fragile blue-and-white oriental porcelain, with matching cups and saucers and other equipage, added prestige as well as elegance to the tea-time ritual. At first, the scarcity and expense of the tea, the costly paraphernalia used to serve it, and the leisure considered necessary to consume it, limited the use of this commodity to the upper classes. For these reasons, social tea-drinking was understandably a prestige custom. One becomes increasingly aware of this when looking at English paintings and prints of the early 18th century, such as Family Group, painted by Gowan Hamilton, about 1730. Family members are portrayed in the familiar setting of their own parlor with its paneled walls and comfortable furnishings. Their pet, a small dog, surveys the scene from a resting place on a corner of the carpet. Tea time appears to have just begun, for cups are still being passed around, and others on the table await filling from the nearby porcelain teapot. It seems reasonable to assume, since the painting is portraiture, that the family is engaged in an activity which, although familiar, is considered suitable to the group's social position and worthy of being recorded in oil. That tea-drinking was a status symbol also is indicated by the fact that the artist has used the tea ceremony as the theme of the picture and the tea-table as the focal point. 18th-century pictures and writings are basic source materials for information about Anglo-American tea-drinking. See the chronological list of pictures consulted on page 90. A number of the pictures are small-scale group or conversation piece paintings of English origin in which family and friends are assembled at tea, similar to family group, and they provide pictorial information on tea-time modes and manners. The surroundings in which the partakers of tea are depicted also reveal information about the period and about the gracious living enjoyed in the better homes. Paneled walls and comfortable chairs, handsome chests and decorative curtains, objects of ceramic and silver and glass, all were set down on canvas or paper with painstaking care, and sometimes with a certain amount of artistic license. A careful study of these paintings provides an excellent guide for furnishing and reconstructing period rooms and exhibits, even to the small details such as objects on mantels, tables, and chests, thus further documenting data from newspapers, journals, publications, and writings of the same period. In America, as in England, tea had a rather limited use as a social beverage during the early 1700s. Judge Samuel Sewall, the recorder extraordinary of Boston life at the turn of the 17th century, seems to have mentioned tea only once in his copious diary. In the entry for April 15, 1709, Sewall wrote that he had attended a meeting at the residence of Madam Winthrop, where the guests drank ale, tea, wine. At this time, ale and wine, in contrast to tea, were fairly common drinks. Since tea and the equipment used to serve it were costly, social tea-drinking was restricted to the prosperous and governing classes who could afford the luxury. The portrayal of the rotund silver teapot and other tea-drinking equipment in such an American painting as Susanna Truax, done by an unknown painter in 1730, indicates that in this country, as in England, not only was the tea ceremony of social importance, but also that a certain amount of prestige was associated with the equipage. And the very fact that an artist was commissioned for a portrait of this young girl is suggestive of a more than ordinary social status of the sitter and activity depicted. English customs were generally imitated in this country, particularly in the urban centers. Of Boston, where he visited in 1740, Joseph Bennett observed that the ladies here visit, drink a tea, and indulge every little piece of gentility to the height of the mode, and neglect the affairs of their families with as good grace as the finest ladies in London. English modes and manners remained a part of the social behavior after the colonies became an independent nation. Visitors to the newly formed United States were apt to remark about such habits as tea-drinking, as did Brissot de Varville in 1788, that in this, as in their whole manner of living, the Americans in general resemble the English. Therefore, it is not surprising to find that during the 18th century, the serving of tea privately in the morning and socially in the afternoon or early evening was an established custom in many households. The naturalist Peter Kalm, during his visit to North America in the mid-18th century, noted that tea was a breakfast beverage in both Pennsylvania and New York. From the predominantly Dutch town of Albany in 1749, he wrote that their breakfast is tea, commonly without milk. At another time, Kalm stated, "With the tea was eaten bread and butter, or buttered bread toasted over the coals, so that the butter penetrated the whole slice of bread. In the afternoon, about 3 o'clock, tea was drunk again, in the same fashion, except that bread and butter was not served with it." This tea-drinking schedule was followed throughout the colonies. In Boston, the people take a great deal of tea in the morning, have dinner at 2 o'clock, and about 5 o'clock they take more tea, some wine, Madeira, and punch, reported the Baron Cromot du Bourg during his visit in 1781. The Marquis de Castelux confirms his countryman's statement about tea-time, mentioning that the Americans take a tea and punch in the afternoon. During the first half of the 18th century, the limited amount of tea available at prohibitively high prices restricted its use to a proportionately small segment of the total population of the colonies. About mid-century, however, tea was beginning to be drunk by more and more people as supplies increased and cost decreased, due in part to the propaganda and merchandising efforts of the East India Company. According to Peter Kalm, tea, chocolate, and coffee had been wholly unknown to the Swedish population of Pennsylvania and the surrounding area before the English arrived, but in 1748 these beverages at present constitute even the country people's daily breakfast. A similar observation was made a few years later by Israel Acrelius. Tea, coffee, and chocolate are so general as to be found in the most remote cabins, if not for daily use, yet for visitors, mixed with muscovado or raw sugar. America was becoming a country of tea drinkers. Then, in 1767, the Townsend Act imposed a duty on tea, among other imported commodities. Merchants and citizens in opposition to the act urged a boycott of the taxed articles. A Virginia woman, in a letter to friends in England, wrote in 1769, "I have given up the article of tea, but some are not quite so tractable. However, if we can convince the good folks on your side the water of their error, we may hope to see happier times." In spite of the tax, many colonists continued to indulge in tea-drinking. By 1773, the general public, according to one Philadelphia merchant, can afford to come at this piece of luxury, while one-third of the population, at a moderate computation, drink tea twice a day. It was at this time, however, that efforts were made to enforce the English tea tax, and the result was that most famous of tea parties, the Boston Tea Party. Thereafter, an increasing number of colonists abstained from tea drinking as a patriotic gesture. Philip Fithian, a tutor at Nominee Hall, the Virginia plantation of Colonel Robert Carter, wrote in his journal on Sunday, May 29, 1774, "After dinner we had a grand and agreeable walk in and through the gardens. There is great plenty of strawberries, some cherries, gooseberries, and so forth. Drank coffee at four. They are now too patriotic to use tea." And indeed they were patriotic, for by September the taste of tea almost had been forgotten at Nominee Hall, as Fithian vividly recounted in his journal. "Something in our palace this evening very merry happened. Mrs. Carter made a dish of tea. At coffee she sent me a dish, and the colonel, both ignorant, he smelt, sipped, looked. At last, with great gravity, he asked, 'What's this?' 'Do you ask, sir?' 'Puh!' And out he throws it, splash, a sacrifice to Vulcan." Other colonists, in their own way, also showed their distaste for tea. Shortly before the outbreak of the American Revolution, there appeared in several newspapers an expression of renouncement in rhyme. A lady's adieu to her tea-table, below, which provides a picture of contemporary tea-time etiquette and equipage. A lady's adieu to her tea-table. "Farewell the tea-board, with your gaudy attire, ye cups and ye saucers that I did admire. To my cream-pot and tongs I now bid adieu, that pleasures all fled that I once found in you. Farewell, pretty chest that so lately did shine, with hyson and congo and best double fine. Many a sweet moment by you I have sat, hearing girls and old maids to tattle and chat. And the spruce coxcomb laugh at nothing at all, only some silly work that might happen to fall. No more shall my teapot so generous be in filling the cups with this pernicious tea, for I'll fill it with water and drink out the same before I'll lose liberty, that dearest name, because I am taught, and believe it is fact, that our ruin is aimed at in the late act of imposing a duty on all foreign teas, which detestable stuff we can quit when we please. Liberty's the goddess that I do adore, and I'll maintain her right until my last hour. Before she shall part, I will die in the cause, for I'll never be governed by tyranny's laws." Many people gave up tea for the duration of the war and offered various substitute beverages, such as coffee and dried raspberry leaves, a detestable drink, which the Americans "had the heroism to find good," remarked a post-war visitor, Léon Chateau. Although the colonists had banished tea with enthusiasm, the tea habit was not forgotten. Chateau further noted that they all drink tea in America as they drink wine in the south of France. Tea drinking continued to be an important social custom in the new nation well into the 19th century. The tea ceremony, sometimes simple, sometimes elaborate, was the very core of family life. Moreau de Saint-Méry observed in 1795, during his residence in Philadelphia, that "the whole family is united at tea, to which friends, acquaintances, and even strangers are invited." That tea-time hospitality was offered to the newest of acquaintances, or even strangers, is verified by Claude Blanchard. He wrote of his visit to Newport, Rhode Island, on July 12, 1780, that "in the evening there was an illumination. I entered the house of an inhabitant who received me very well. I took tea there, which was served by a young lady." And while staying in Boston, Blanchard mentioned that a new acquaintance invited us to come in the evening to take tea at his house. We went there. The tea was served by his daughter. In the daily routine of activities, when the hour for tea arrived, Moreau de Saint-Méry remarked that "the mistress of the house serves it and passes it around." In the words of another late 18th-century diarist, the Marquis de Barbey-Morbois, Those present might seat themselves at a spotless mahogany table, and the eldest daughter of the household or one of the youngest married women makes the tea and gives a cup to each person in the company. Family group provides an illustration of this practice in the early part of the century. During the tea hour, social and economic affairs were discussed, gossip exchanged, and according to Barbé Marbois, when there is no news at all, they repeat old stories. Many entries in Nancy Shippen's journal between 1783 and 1786 indicate that this Philadelphian passed many such hours in a similar manner. On March 11, 1785, she wrote, "About four in the afternoon, Dr. Cutting came in, and we spent the afternoon in the most agreeable chit-chat manner, drank a very good dish of tea together, and then separated." Part of an undated entry in December 1783 reads, "This afternoon we were honored with the company of General Washington to tea, Mrs. and Major Moore, Mrs. Stewart, Mr. Powell, Mr. B. Washington, and two or three more." If acquaintances of Nancy's own age were present, or the company large, the tea hour often extended well into the evening, with singing, conversing, dancing, and playing of whist, chess, or cards. Of one such occasion she wrote, "Mrs. Allen and Miss Hughes drank tea with me and spent the evening. There was half a dozen agreeable and sensible men that was of the party. The conversation was carried on in the most sprightly, agreeable manner, the ladies bearing by far the greatest part, till nine when cards was proposed, and about ten refreshments were introduced, which concluded the evening." Obviously, young men and women enjoyed the sociability of tea-time, for it provided an ideal occasion to get acquainted. When the Marquis de Chastellux was in Philadelphia during the 1780s, he went one afternoon to take tea with Madame Shippen, and found musical entertainment to meet with his approval, and a relationship between the sexes which had parental sanction. One young miss played on the clavichord, and Miss Shippen sang with timidity but a very pretty voice, accompanied for a time by Monsieur Otto on the harp. Dancing followed, noted the Marquis, while mothers and other grave personages conversed in another room. In New York, as in Philadelphia, tea-time was an important part of the younger set's social schedule. Eliza Bone, writing to her sister in January 1810, reported that, "As to news, New York is not so gay as last winter, few balls but a great many tea-parties." The feminine interest and participation in such gatherings of personable young men and attractive young women was expressed by Nancy Shippen when she wrote in her journal after such a party, "Saturday night at 11 o'clock, I had a very large company at tea this evening. The company is but just broke up. I don't know when I spent a more merry evening. We had music, cards, and so forth." A masculine view of American tea-parties was openly voiced by one foreign visitor, Prince de Broglie, who upon arrival in America in 1782 only knew a few words of English, but knew better how to drink excellent tea with even better cream, how to tell a lady she was pretty, and a gentleman he was sensible, by reason whereof I possessed all the elements of social success. Similar feelings were expressed by the Comte de Ségur during his sojourn in America in the late 18th century, when in a letter to his wife in France he wrote, "My health continues excellent, despite the quantity of tea one must drink with the ladies out of gallantry, and of Madeira all day long with the men out of politeness." Festive tea-parties, such as the ones described above, are the subject of some of the group portraits or conversation pieces painted about 1730 by the English artist William Hogarth. The assembly at Bonstead House, now in the Philadelphia Museum of Art, illustrates quite an elegant affair taking place in a large, richly decorated English interior. The artist has filled the canvas with people standing and conversing, while a seated group plays cards at a table in the center of the room. To one side, near the fireplace, a man and two women drinking tea are seated at an ornately carved square tea-table with a matching stand for the hot water kettle. On a dish or circular stand in the center of the table is a squat teapot with matching cups and saucers arranged in parallel rows on either side. Tea-drinking guests seem to have been free to sit or stand according to their own pleasure or the number of chairs available, and Barbé Marbois noted that at American tea-parties people change seats, some go, others come. The written and visual materials offer little in the way of evidence to suggest that in general men stood and women sat during tea-time. In fact, places at the tea-table were taken by both sexes, even at formal tea-parties, such as the one depicted in The Assembly at Wanstead House. A less formal but more usual tea-scene is the subject of another Hogarth painting, The Wollaston Family, now in the Leicester Art Gallery, England. The afternoon gathering has divided into two groups, one playing cards, the other drinking tea. An atmosphere of ease and comfort surrounds the party. The men and women seated at the card table are discussing the hand just played, while the women seated about the square tea table in front of the fireplace are engaged in conversation. A man listens as he stands and stirs his tea. Each drinker holds a saucer with a cup filled from the teapot on a square tile or stand in the center of the table. One woman is returning her cup, turned upside down on the saucer, to the table. More about this particular habit later. End of part one. Part two of Tea Drinking in 18th Century America by Rodris Roth. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. The same pleasant social atmosphere seen in English paintings seems to have surrounded tea time in America, as the previously cited entries in Nancy Shippen's journal book suggest. Her entry for January 18, 1784, supplies a description that almost matches the Wollaston family. A stormy day, alone till the afternoon, and then was honored with the company of Mr. Jones, a gentleman lately from Europe, Mr. Duponceur, and Mr. Hollingsworth at tea. We conversed on a variety of subjects and played at whist. Upon the whole, spent an agreeable evening. Tea was not only a beverage of courtship, it also was associated with marriage. Both Peter Kalm in 1750 and Moreau de Saint-Marie in the 1790s report the Philadelphia custom of expressing good wishes to a newly married couple by paying them a personal visit soon after the marriage. It was the duty of the bride to serve wine and punch to the callers before noon, and tea and wine in the afternoon. No doubt make-believe tea-time and pretend tea-drinking were a part of some children's playtime activities. Perhaps many a little girl played at serving tea and dreamed of having a tea-party of her own, but few were as fortunate as young Peggy Livingston, who at about the age of 5 was allowed to invite, by card, 20 young misses to her own tea-party and ball. She treated them with all good things and a violin, wrote her grandfather. There were 5 coaches at the door and 10 when they departed. I was much amused 2 hours. Tea seems to have been the excuse for many a social gathering, large or small, formal or informal, and sometimes an invitation to drink tea meant a rather elegant party. That is to say, wrote one cosmopolitan observer of the American scene in the 1780s, the Marquis de Chastellux, to attend a sort of assembly pretty much like the conversazione, social gathering, of Italy, for tea here is the substitute for the renfresco, refreshment. A view of such an event has been depicted in the English print Conversazione, published in 1782. It is hoped that the stiffly seated and solemn-faced guests became more talkative when the tea arrived. However, this tea-party may have been like the ones Ferdinand Bayard attended in Bath, Virginia, of which he wrote, "The only thing you hear while they are taking tea is the whistling sound made by the lips on edges of the cups. This music is varied by the request made to you to have another cup." At tea parties, cakes, cold pastries, sweetmeats, preserved fruits, and plates of cracked nuts might also be served, according to Mrs. Anne Grant's reminiscences of pre-revolutionary America. Peter Kalm noted during his New York sojourn in 1749 that when you paid a visit to any home, a bowl of cracked nuts and one of apples were set before you, which you ate after drinking tea and even at times whilst partaking of tea. Sometimes wine and punch were served at tea-time, and in summer, observed Barbet Marbois, they add fruit and other things to drink. Coffee, too, might be served, as the Frenchman Claude Blanchard explained. They, the Americans, do not take coffee immediately after dinner, but it is served 3 or 4 hours afterwards with tea. This coffee is weak, and 4 or 5 cups are not equal to 1 of ours, so that they take many of them. The tea, on the contrary, is very strong. This use of tea and coffee is universal in America. Dealing with both food and drink at the same time was something of an art. It was also an inconvenience for the uninitiated, and on one occasion Ferdinand Bayard, a late 18th-century observer of American tea ritual, witnessed another guest who, after having taken a cup of tea in one hand and tartlets in the other, opened his mouth and told the servant to fill it for him with smoked venison. While foreign visitors recognized that the greatest mark of courtesy a host and hostess could offer a guest was a cup of tea, hospitality could be hot-water torture for foreigners unless they understood the social niceties not only of holding a cup and tartlet, but of declining without offending by turning the cup upside down and placing a spoon upon it. The ceremony of the teaspoon is fully explained by the Prince de Broglie, who, during his visit to Philadelphia in 1782, reported the following tea-time incident at the home of Robert Morris. "I partook of most excellent tea, and I should be even now still drinking it, I believe, if the French ambassador had not charitably notified me at the 12th cup that I must put my spoon across it when I wished to finish with this sort of warm water. He said to me, 'It is almost as ill-bred to refuse a cup of tea when it is offered to you, as it would be indiscreet for the mistress of the house to propose a fresh one, when the ceremony of the spoon has notified her that we no longer wish to partake of it.'" Bayard reports that one quick-witted foreigner, uninformed as to the teaspoon signal, had had his cup filled again and again, until he finally decided after emptying it to put it into his pocket until the replenishments had been concluded. The gracious art of brewing and serving tea was as much an instrument of sociability as was a bit of music or conversation. This custom received the attention of a number of artists, and it is amazing what careful and detailed treatment they gave to the accessories of tea. We are familiar with the journals, newspaper advertisements, and other writings that provide contemporary reports on this custom, but it is to the artist we turn for a more clearly defined view. The painter saw, arranged, and gave us a visual image, sometimes richly informative, as in Tea Party in the time of George the First, of the different tea-time items and how they were used. The unknown artist of this painting, done about 1725, has carefully illustrated each piece of equipment considered appropriate for the tea ceremony and used for brewing the tea in the cups held with such grace by the gentleman and child. Throughout the 18th century, the well-equipped tea table would have displayed most of the items seen in this painting: a teapot, slop bowl, container for milk or cream, tea canister, sugar container, tongs, teaspoons, and cups and saucers. These pieces were basic to the tea ceremony, and with the addition of a tea urn, which came into use during the latter part of the 18th century, have remained the established tea equipage up to the present day. Even a brief investigation of about 20 inventories, itemized lists of the goods and property of deceased persons that were required by law, reveal that in New York between 1742 and 1768, teapots, cups and saucers, teaspoons, and tea canisters were owned by both low and high income groups in both urban and rural areas. The design and ornament of the tea vessels and utensils, of course, differed according to the fashion of the time, and the various items associated with the beverage provide a good index of the stylistic change in the 18th century. The simple designs and unadorned surfaces of the plump, pear-shaped teapot in Tea Party in the Time of George I, and the spherical one seen in the portrait Susanna Truax, mark these pieces as examples of the late Baroque style popular in the early part of the 18th century. About mid-century, teapots of inverted pear shape associated with the Rococo style began to appear. A pot of this shape is depicted in the portrait Paul Revere, painted about 1765 by John Singleton Copley and owned by the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston. The fact that a teapot was chosen as an example of Revere's craft from all of the objects he made indicates that such a vessel was valued as highly by its maker as by its owner. The teapot was a mark of prestige for both craftsman and hostess. Apparently, the famous silversmith and patriot was still working on the piece, for the nearby tools suggest that the teapot was to have engraved and chased decoration, perhaps of flowers, scrolls, and other motifs typical of the Rococo style. The restrained decoration and linear outlines of the teapot illustrated in the print titled The Old Maid, and the straight sides and oval shape of the teapot belonging to a late 18th century child set of Chinese export porcelain, are characteristics of the neoclassic style that was fashionable at the end of the century. Tea drinkers were extremely conscious of fashion changes, and whenever possible set their tea tables with stylish equipment in the prevailing fashion. Newspaper advertisements, journals, letters, and other written materials indicate that utensils in the best and newest taste were available, desired, purchased, and used in this country. Further verification of the types and kinds of equipage used is supplied by archaeological investigations of colonial sites. For instance, shards or fragments of objects dug from or near the site of a dwelling at Marlborough, Virginia, owned and occupied by John Mercer between 1726 and 1768, included a silver teaspoon made about 1735 and two teapot tops, one a pewter lid and the other a Staffordshire salt glaze cover made about 1745, as well as numerous pieces of blue and white oriental porcelain cups and saucers. Such archaeological data provides concrete proof about tea furnishings used in this country. A comparison of shards from colonial sites with wares used by the English and of English origin indicates that similar types of equipage were to be found upon tea tables in both countries. This also substantiates the already cited American practice of following English modes and manners, a practice Brissot de Vaville noted in 1788, when he wrote that in this country tea forms, as in England, the basis of the principal parties of pleasure. Tea furnishings, when in use, were to be seen upon rectangular tables with four legs, square top and circular top tripods, and Pembroke tables. Such tables were, of course, used for other purposes, but a sampling of 18th-century Boston inventories reveals that in some households all or part of the tea paraphernalia was prominently displayed on the tea table rather than being stored in cupboards or closets. A japanned tea table and china, and a mahogany do and china, both in the great room, are listed in Mrs. Hannah Pemberton's inventory, recorded in Boston in 1758. The inventory of Joseph Blake of Boston, recorded in 1746, lists a tea table with a set of china furniture in the back room of the house, while in the closet in the front room were six teacups and saucers along with other ceramic wares. The most popular type of tea table apparently was the circular tripod, that is, a circular top supported on a pillar with 3 feet. This kind of table is seen again and again in the prints and paintings, and is listed in the inventories of the period. These tables, usually of walnut or mahogany, had stationary or tilt tops with plain, scalloped, or carved edges. Square or round, tripod or four-legged, the tables were usually placed against the wall of the room until tea-time, when, in the words of Ferdinand Bayard, a mahogany table is brought forward and placed in front of the lady who pours the tea. This practice is depicted in a number of 18th-century pictures, with the tea-table well out in the room, often in front of a fireplace, and with seated and standing figures at or near the table. Evidence of such furniture placement in American parlors is recorded in a sketch and note Nancy Shippen received from one of her beaux, who wrote in part, "This evening I passed your house, and seeing company in the parlor, I peeped through the window and saw a considerable tea company, of which by their situation I could only distinguish four persons. You will see the plan of this company upon the next page." In the sketch, a floor plan of the Shippen parlor, we can see the sofa against the wall between the windows, while chairs and tea-table have been moved out in the room. The table is near the fireplace where Miss Shippen served the tea. In the 18th century, such an arrangement was first and foremost one of comfort, and perhaps also of taste. The diary of Jakob Hiltzheimer indicates that in 1786 the first signs of fall were felt on August 1st, for the Philadelphian wrote, "This evening it was so cool that we drank tea by the fire." In the South, as in the North, tea, or at the time of the American Revolution, its patriotic substitute, coffee, was served by the fire as soon as the first winter winds were felt. Philip Fithian, while at Nominee Hall in Virginia, wrote in his journal on September 19, 1774, "The air is clear, cold, and healthful. We drank our coffee at the great house very sociably around a fine fire. The house and air feels like winter again." Tablecloths, usually square white ones, that showed folds from having been stored in a linen press, were used when tea was served, but it is difficult to say with any certainty if their use depended upon the whim of the hostess, the type of the table, or the time of day. A cloth probably was used more often on a table with a plain top than on one with scalloped or carved edges. However, as can be seen in Family Group and An English Family at Tea, it was perfectly acceptable to serve tea on a plain-top table without a cloth. Apparently such tables were also used at breakfast or morning tea, because Benjamin Franklin, in a letter from London dated February 19, 1758, gave the following directions for the use of 6-course diaper breakfast cloths, which he sent to his wife. "They are to spread on the tea-table, for nobody breakfasts here on the naked table, but on the cloth set a large tea-board with the cups." Some of the 18th-century paintings depicting tea-tables with cloths do deal with the morning hours, as indicated by their titles or internal evidence, as in The Honeymoon, painted by John Collett about 1760. In this scene of domestic confusion and bliss, a tray or tea-board has been placed on the cloth, illustrating Franklin's comment about English breakfast habits. Cloths may be seen in pictures in which the time of day cannot be determined. Therefore, the use of a cloth at tea-time may, in truth, have depended upon the hostess's whim, if not her pocketbook. In addition, trays or tea-boards of various sizes and shapes were sometimes used. They were usually circular or rectangular in form, occasionally of shaped or scalloped outline. Some trays were supported upon low feet. Others had pierced or fretwork galleries or edges to prevent the utensils from slipping off. Wood or metal was the usual material, although ceramic trays were also used. At large gatherings, a tray was often employed for passing refreshments. A servant brings in on a silver tray the cups, the sugar bowl, the cream jugs, pats of butter, and smoked meat, which are offered to each individual, explained Ferdinand Bayard. The principal use of the tray was, of course, to bring the tea equipage to the table. Whether placed on a bare or covered table, it arrived with the various pieces, such as cups and saucers, spoons, containers for sugar and cream or milk, tongs, bowls, and dishes, arranged about the teapot. Such tea furnishings of ceramic were sold in sets, that is, all pieces being of the same pattern. Newspaper advertisements in the 1730s specifically mention tea sets, and later in the century ceramic imports continue to include beautiful complete tea sets. In the early 18th century, tea sets of silver were uncommon, if not actually unique, though pieces were occasionally made to match existing items, and in this way a so-called set similar to the pieces seen in Tea Party in the time of George I could be formed. However, by the latter part of the century, the wealthier hostesses were able to purchase from among a most elegant assortment of silver plate complete tea and coffee services, plain and rich engraved. When of metal, tea sets usually consisted of a teapot, containers for sugar and cream or milk, and possibly a slop bowl, while ceramic sets, such as the one seen in Family Group, included cups and saucers as well. While the tea set illustrated in Family Group appears to have all the basic pieces, it can hardly be considered a complete tea set when compared with the following porcelain sets listed in the 1747 inventory of James Pemberton of Boston. One set, burnt china, containing 12 cups and saucers, slop bowl, teapot, milk pot, boat for spoons, tea canister, sugar dish, five-handle cups, plate for the teapot, and a white teapot, value £20. One set, blue and white doux, containing 12 cups and saucers, slop bowl, two plates, sugar dish, teapot, six-handle cups, and white teapot, value £10. In addition, the Pemberton inventory lists a silver teapot and one pair tea tongs and strainer, items that were undoubtedly used with the ceramic sets. Tea sets were even available for the youngest hostess, and the several complete tea table sets of children's cream-colored ceramic toys mentioned in a Boston advertisement of 1771 no doubt added a note of luxury to make-believe tea parties during playtime. The pieces in children's tea sets, such as the ones pictured from a child set of Chinese export porcelain, usually were like those of regular sets and differed only in size. Little Miss Livingston must have been happy indeed when her uncle wrote that he had sent a complete tea apparatus for her baby doll. Her doll may now invite her cousin's doll to tea and parade her tea table in form. This must be no small gratification to her. It would be fortunate if happiness were always attainable with equal ease. The pieces of tea equipage could be purchased individually. For instance, teacups and saucers, which are differentiated in advertisements from both coffee and chocolate cups, regularly appear in lists of ceramic wares offered for sale, such as very handsome sets of blue and white china teacups and saucers, or enameled, penciled, and gilt, red and white, blue and white, enameled and scalloped teacups and saucers. These adjectives, used by 18th-century salesmen, usually referred to the types and colors of the decorations that were painted on the pieces. Enameled most likely meant that the decorations were painted over the glaze, and penciled may have implied motifs painted with a fine black line of pencil-like appearance, while gilt, red and white, and blue and white were the colors and type of the decoration. Blue and white china was perhaps the most popular type of teaware, for it regularly appears in newspaper advertisements and inventories, and among shards from colonial sites. Concerning tea, the Abbé Robin went so far as to say that there is not a single person to be found who does not drink it out of china cups and saucers. However exaggerated the statement may be, it does reflect the popularity and availability of Chinese export porcelain in the post-revolutionary period, when Americans were at last free to engage in direct trade with the Orient. Porcelain for the American market was made in a wide variety of forms, as well as in complete dinner and tea sets, and was often decorated to special order. Hand-painted monograms, insignia of various kinds, and patriotic motifs were especially popular. A tea set decorated in this way was sent to Dr. David Townsend of Boston, a member of the Society of the Cincinnati, by a fellow member of the Society, Major Samuel Shaw, American consul at Canton. In a letter to Townsend from Canton, China, dated December 20, 1790, Shaw wrote, "Accept, my dear friend, as a mark of my esteem and affection, a tea set of porcelain, ornamented with the Cincinnati and your cipher. I hope shortly after its arrival to be with you, and in company with your amiable partner, see whether a little good tea improves or loses any part of its flavor in passing from one hemisphere to the other." Appended to the letter was the following inventory, which provides us with a list of the pieces deemed essential for a fashionable set tea table: 2 teapots and stands, sugar bowl and dough, milk ewer, bowl and dish, 6 breakfast cups and saucers, 12 afternoon dew. Porcelain, however, had long been a part of China trade cargoes to Europe and from there to America. The early shipments of tea had included such appropriate vessels for the storage, brewing, and drinking of the herb as tea jars, teapots, and tea cups. The latter were small porcelain bowls without handles, a form which the Europeans and Americans adopted and continued to use throughout the 18th century for tea, in contrast to the deeper and somewhat narrower cups, usually with handles, in which chocolate and coffee were served. Even after Europeans learned to manufacture porcelain early in the 18th century, the ware continued to be imported from China in large quantities, and was called by English-speaking people China from its country of origin. Porcelain also was referred to as India China ware, after the English and Continental East India Companies, the original traders and importers of the ware. Burnt china was another term used in the 18th century to differentiate porcelain from pottery. Whatever the ware, the teacups and saucers, whether on a tray, the cloth, or a bare table, were usually arranged in an orderly manner about the teapot, generally in rows on a rectangular table or tray, and in a circle on a round table or tray. In the English conversation piece painting titled Mr. and Mrs. Hill in Their Drawing Room by Arthur Davis about 1750, the circular tripod tea table between the couple and in front of the fireplace is set in such a way. The handleless teacups on saucers are neatly arranged in a large semicircle around the rotund teapot in the center that is flanked on one side by a bowl and on the other by a jug for milk or cream and a sugar container. Generally, cups and saucers were not piled one upon the other, but spread out on the table or tray where they were filled with tea and then passed to each guest. End of part 2. Part 3 of Tea Drinking in 18th Century America by Rodris Roth. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Pictures show male and female guests holding both cup and saucer, or just the cup. An English satirical print, The Old Maid, published in 1777, was the only illustration found that depicted an individual using a dish for tea, or to be exact, a saucer. In the 18th century, a dish of tea was in reality a cup of tea, for the word dish meant a cup or vessel used for drinking, as well as a utensil to hold food at meals. A play on this word is evident in the following exchange reported by Philip Fithian between himself and Mrs. Carter, the mistress of Nominee Hall, one October forenoon in 1773. "Shall I help you, Mr. Fithian, to a dish of coffee?" "I choose a deep plate, if you please, ma'am, and milk." The above suggests that the practice of saucer sipping, while it may have been common among the general public, was frowned upon by polite society. The fact that Americans preferred and were accustomed to eating everything hot further explains why tea generally was drunk from the cup instead of the saucer. According to Peter Calm, when the English women, that is, of English descent, drank tea, they never poured it out of the cup into the saucer to cool it, but drank it as hot as it came from the teapot. Later in the century, another naturalist, C. F. Volney, also noted that very hot tea was beloved by Americans of English descent. From this it would appear that dish of tea was an expression rather than a way of drinking tea in the 18th century. On the table a saucer seems always to have been placed under the cup, whether the cup was right side up or upside down. Teaspoons, when in use, might be placed on the saucer or left in the cups. The portrait titled Mrs. Combs, painted by G. Freymeyer in 1806, indicates that handling a cup with the spoon in it could be accomplished with a certain amount of grace. Teaspoons also were placed in a pile on the table, or in a silver boat for teaspoons, or more often in such ceramic containers as delfware spoon trays, or blue and white or stenciled china spoon boats. Tongs were especially suited for lifting the lumps of sugar from their container to the teacup. During the 18th century, both arched and scissor-type tongs were used. Instead of points, the latter had dainty flat grips for holding a lump of sugar. The early arched tongs were round in section, as are the pair illustrated in Tea Party in the time of George I, while tongs made by arching or bending double a flat strip of silver date from the second half of the 18th century. These articles of tea equipage, variously known as tongs, tea tongs, silver tea tongs, and sugar tongs, were usually made of silver, though ivory and wooden tea tongs were advertised in 1763. According to the prints and paintings of the period, tongs were placed in or near the sugar container. Teaspoons were also used for sugar, as illustrated in the painting Susanna Truax. Perhaps young Miss Truax is about to indulge in a custom favored by the Dutch population of Albany, as reported by Peter Kalm in 1749. They never put sugar into the cup, but take a small bit of it into their mouth while they drink. Shallow dishes, such as the one seen in the portrait Susanna Truax, and hemispherical bowls, were used as containers for sugar. Often called sugar dishes or just sugars, they were available in delftware, glass, and silver, as well as in blue and white, burnt, enameled, and penciled china. Some containers were sold with covers, and it has been suggested that the saucer-shaped cover of the hemispherical sugar bowl or dish, fashionable in the first half of the 18th century, also served as a spoon tray. However, in the painting Tea Party at the time of George I, the cover is leaning against the bowl, and the spoons are in an oval spoon tray or boat. Another possibility, if the lid was multipurpose, is that it was used as a dish or stand under the teapot to protect the tabletop. Silver sugar boxes, basins, and plated sugar baskets were other forms used to hold sugar, which, in whatever container, was a commodity important to the Americans. As Moreau de Saint-Marie noted, they use great quantities in their tea. Containers for cream or milk may be seen in many of the 18th century tea-time pictures, and are found in the advertisements of the period under a variety of names. There were cream pots of glass and pewter and silver, jugs of penciled and burnt china, and in the 1770s one could obtain enameled and plain three-footed cream jugs from Mr. Henry William Stiegel's glass factory at Mannheim, Pennsylvania. There were cream pails, urns, and ewers of silver plate, and plated cream basins, gilt inside. Milk pots, used on some tea tables instead of cream containers, were available in silver, pewter, ceramic, and sprigged, cut-and-molded glass. Although contemporary diarists and observers of American customs seem not to have noticed whether cream was served cold and milk hot, or if tea drinkers were given a choice between cream and milk, the Prince de Broglie's comment already cited concerning his ability to drink excellent tea with even better cream, and the predominance of cream over milk containers in 18th century advertisements, would seem to indicate that in this country cream rather than milk was served with tea in the afternoon. While the Americans, as the Europeans, added cream or milk and sugar to their tea, the use of lemon with the beverage is questionable. Nowhere is there any indication that the citrus fruit was served or used with tea in 18th century America. Punch seems to have been the drink with which lemons were associated. Often a medium-sized bowl, usually hemispherical in shape, is to be seen on the tea-table, and it is most likely a slop bowl or basin. According to advertisements, these bowls and basins were available in silver, pewter, and ceramic. Before a teacup was replenished, the remaining tea and dregs were emptied into the slop bowl. Then the cup might be rinsed with hot water, and the rinsing water discarded in the bowl. The slop basin may also have been the receptacle for the mote or foreign particles then inherent in tea, but now extracted by mechanical means, that had to be skimmed off the beverage in the cup. In England, this was probably done with a small utensil known to present-day collectors as a mote spoon or mote skimmer. Although the exact purpose of these spoons remains unsettled, it seems likely that they were used with tea. It has been suggested that the perforated bowl of the spoon was used for skimming foreign particles off the tea in the cup, and the tapering spike-like stem to clear the clogged-up strainer of the teapot spout. The almost complete absence of American-made mote spoons suggests that these particular utensils were seldom used here. Possibly the skimmer, advertised in 1727 with other silver tea pieces, was such a spoon. No doubt tea strainers were also used to ensure clear tea. The tea dregs might then be discarded in the slop bowl or left in the strainer, and the strainer rested on the bowl. However, only a few contemporary American advertisements and inventories have been found which mention tea strainers. Punch strainers, though generally larger in size, seem to have doubled as tea strainers in some households. The 1757 inventory of Charles Brockwell of Boston includes a punch strainer, which is listed not with the wine glasses and other pieces associated with punch, but with the tea items. One small dough, a china milk pot, one teapot, six cups and three saucers, and one punch strainer. Presumably the strainer had just been used for tea. The teapot was, of course, the very center of the social custom of drinking tea, so it usually was found in the center of the tray or table. At first, only teapots of Oriental origin imported with the cargoes of tea were available, for the teapot had been unknown to Europeans before the introduction of the beverage. However, as tea gained acceptance as a social drink and the demand for equipage increased, local craftsmen were stimulated to produce wares that could compete with the Chinese imports. Teapots based on Chinese models and often decorated with Chinese motifs were fashioned in ceramic and silver. No doubt, many an 18th-century hostess desired a silver teapot to grace her table and add an elegant air to the tea ceremony. A lottery offering one must have raised many a hope, especially if, as an advertisement of 1727 announced, the highest prize consists of an 8-square teapot, as well as 6 teaspoons, skimmer, and tongs. By the end of the century, an elegant silver teapot with ornamental lid resembling a pineapple would have been the wish of a fashion-conscious hostess. Less expensive than silver, but just as stylish, according to the merchant's advertisements, were newest fashion teapots of pewter, or in the late 18th century, Britannia metal teapots. The latest mode in ceramic ware also was to be found upon the tea table. In the mid-18th century, it was English brown china teapots of sorts, with a raised flower, probably the ceramic with a deep, rich brown glaze known today as Jackfield-type ware, black, green and tortoise, a pottery glazed with variegated colors in imitation of tortoise shell, and enameled stone teapots. At the time of the American Revolution, teaware imports included Egyptian, Etruscan, embossed red china, agate, green, black, cauliflower, white and blue and white stone enameled, striped, fluted, pierced and plain queensware teapots. Sometimes the teapot, whether ceramic, pewter or silver, was placed upon a dish or small tile-like stand with feet. These teapot stands served as insulation by protecting the surface of the table or tray from the damaging heat of the teapot. Stands often were included in tea sets, but also were sold individually, such as the Penciled China Teapot Stands, advertised in 1775, and the teapot stands of Best London Plated Ware, imported in 1797. The stands must have been especially useful when silver equipage was set on a bare tabletop. Many of the silver teapots of elliptical shape with a flat base, so popular in the latter part of the 18th century, had matching stands raised on short legs to protect the table from the expanse of hot metal. On occasion, the teapot was placed on a spirit lamp or burner to keep the beverage warm. In most instances, it was the hot water kettle that sat upon a spirit lamp or burner rather than a teapot. Kettles were usually related to the form of contemporary teapots, but differed in having a swing handle on top and a large, rather flat base that could be placed over the flame. Advertisements mention tea kettles of copper, pewter, brass, and silver, some with lamps and stands. The actual making of tea was part of the ceremony and was usually done by the hostess at the tea table. This necessitated a ready supply of boiling water close at hand to properly infuse the tea, and, as Ferdinand Bayard reported, it also weakens the tea or serves to clean up the cups. Thus, the kettle and burner on their own individual table or stand were placed within easy reach of the tea table. According to 18th-century pictures, the kettle was an important part of the tea setting, but it seldom appeared on the tea table. Special stands for kettles generally were made in the same form as the tea tables, though smaller in scale. The square stands often had a slide on which to place the teapot when the hot water was poured into it. Both pictures and advertisements reveal that by the 1770s, the tea urn was a new form appearing at tea time in place of the hot water kettle. Contrary to its name, the tea urn seldom held tea. These large silver or silver-plated vessels, some of which looked like vases with domed covers, usually had two handles on the shoulders and a spout with a tap in the front near the bottom. Pontypool, japanned, crimson, and gold-striped Roman tea urns, imported from Europe, were among the fashionable tea wares advertised at the end of the 18th century. The urn might be placed on a stand of its own near the table or on the tray or table in the midst of the other equipage, as it is in the painting titled The Honeymoon. Wherever placed, it signified the newest mode in tea-time furnishings. One Baltimorean, O. H. Williams, in a letter dated April 12, 1786, to a close friend, enthusiastically explained that tea and coffee urns plated, mine are partially plated and are extremely neat, are the genteelest things of the sort used now at any house and tables inferior to the first fortunes. The tea canister, a storage container for the dry tea leaves, was yet another piece of equipment to be found on the table or tray. Ceramic canisters of blue and white and red and gold could be purchased to match other tea furnishings of the same ware, and silver tea canisters often were fashioned to harmonize with the silver teapots of the period. Individual canisters were produced, as well as canisters in sets of two or three. A set of canisters usually was kept in the box in which it came, a case known as a tea chest or tea caddy, such as the elegant assortment of tea caddies with one, two, and three canisters, advertised in 1796. Canister tops, if dome-shaped, were used to measure out the tea and transfer it to the teapot. Otherwise, small, short-handled spoons with broad, shallow bowls known as caddy spoons and caddy ladles were used. However handled, the tea could have been any one of the numerous kinds available in the 18th century. Although Hyson, Suhong, and Congo, the names inscribed on the canister in Figure 22, may have been favored, there were many other types of tea, as the following advertisement from the Boston Newsletter of September 16, 1736, indicates. To be sold, at the Three Sugar Loaves and Canister, very choice teas, viz. Bohea tea from 22 shillings to 28 shillings per pound, Konju tea 34 shillings, Pico tea 50 shillings per pound, green tea from 20 shillings to 30 shillings per pound, fine imperial tea from 40 shillings to 60 shillings per pound. In the 18th century, tea drinking was an established social custom with a recognized etiquette and distinctive equipage, as we know from the pictures and writings of the period. At tea time, men and women gathered to pursue leisurely conversations and enjoy the sociability of the home. A study of An English Family at Tea will summarize the etiquette and equipage of the ritual. On the floor near the table is a caddy with the top open, showing one canister of a pear. The mistress of the house, seated at the tea table, is measuring out dry tea leaves from the other canisters into its lid. Members of the family stand or sit around the square tea table while they observe this first step in the ceremony. A maidservant stands ready with a hot water kettle to pour the boiling water over the leaves once they are in the teapot. In the background is the tripod kettle stand with a lamp, where the kettle will be placed until needed to rinse the cups or dilute the tea. Not seen in this detail of the painting is the entry of a male servant who is carrying a tall silver pot which may have contained chocolate or coffee. These two other social beverages of the 18th century were served in cups of a deep cylindrical shape, like the three seen on the end of the table. The shallow, bowl-shaped, handleless teacups and the saucers are arranged in a neat row along one side of the table. The teapot rests on a square, tile-like stand or dish that protects the table from the heat. Nearby is a bowl to receive tea dregs, a pot for cream or milk, and a sugar bowl. The tea-time ritual has begun. End of Part 3. End of Tea Drinking in the 18th Century by Rodris Roth.